Good morning and welcome to Greystones Presbyterian Church. Today we are actually in the church, which is wonderful. But when I say we, I mean me. I'm here, but the congregation are not. But you are out there. In a sense, we're joining together to meet in this place. It's been quite a while since we met in the church as a congregation, and who knows, it may be quite a while before we do get to meet in here again. But we'll look forward to that day, and it'll be an amazing celebration. But thank you for joining us today. So wherever you are in the world, welcome to Greystones Presbyterian Church. I'm going to read some words from Psalm 103 as an introduction. This is a psalm of David. So let us worship God. Bless the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. So, this is our God who we have come to worship this morning, and we're going to do that as we sing two songs. The first one is, Bless the Lord, O my soul, 10,000 reasons. The second one is, What a beautiful name it is. So let's worship God.
Oh, my soul, worship his holy name.
Powerful name to pray. Our prayers are going to be led by the Evans family, so over to them. Let's pray.
Lord Jesus, in this time of rest, help us to look to you afresh, to renew our spirits, to fill us with peace, hope, and joy. Thank you for opening our eyes to the gifts you've given us. We're enjoying the birds singing loudly, the bumblebee and butterfly filled gardens, our rivers to paddle in, our primroses to admire, water to drink, food to eat, our comfy beds to sleep in. Thank you for all the memories that we're creating. Thank you for this opportunity to be still, to reset, and to trust completely in you. We love you and we need you. We give you our praise and thanks this and every day.
Thank you, Lord, for our frontline staff, for our doctors, for our nurses. And now with this pandemic, we have so many more frontline staff. We have caterers, our police, ambulance drivers, our firemen and firewomen. Our guards keep an eye on the roads, and we just pray our thoughts with them and their families. So many of them are making such huge sacrifices for the hours they're working and the conditions they're working in. We also pray for the supermarkets. We have such a good supply of food coming in, and people that are working so hard and longer hours to get our food to and from our supermarkets. And thank the Lord that everybody is working well and getting themselves through supermarkets and getting home with their food between different times and different hours of the day. And thank you, Lord, for so many other unseen work that's been done, and cleaners that are in our hospitals that are, their job seems now more important than ever, that they may have got thanked before for the work they've done. And anybody who's out there, and people in Dublin feeding the homeless, again, possibly putting themselves at risk or families at risk, but knowing that there's people out there still so needy in our time of need, that these less fortunate people are in such need as well. So our thoughts and prayers are with all of them, and we pray that people can continue doing what they're doing, and hopefully we can get through this pandemic and let things be getting better for us much sooner. Amen.
I'm thankful that there is robins in our garden, and that there has been a nest built in the bush, a robin's nest built in the bush with 5 baby chicks, and that they're able to be getting their worms to eat, and that they're even able to find them, and that they're safe from maybe birds that could eat them and storms. Mm-hmm.
Lovely. Amen.
Amen.
You this morning, but we do have a song for you this morning. So are you feeling energetic? Are you ready to do the actions? Ready to sing the words? Come on, come on. We need lots of energy for this song. Ready? Let's go.
I am free, I am living for eternity. Psalm 51, verses 1 to 12. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me, yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me to the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Amen.
So we're thinking about the Beatitudes. Thanks, Mark, for that reading from Psalm 51. But we're continuing our thinking about the Beatitudes as found in Matthew chapter 5. We began last week with the first one, which is, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. I said last week about how that one and the one we're doing today are foundational in applying the other Beatitudes to our lives. Do you remember Jesus went up a mountainside? There were lots of people there, but it was his disciples that he was talking to primarily, because the Sermon on the Mount is for the disciples. It is for the followers of Jesus. It doesn't make sense if you're not following Jesus. Other people are listening, but this is primarily teaching for his disciples, and so it is today. So we thought about the poor in spirit, and we teased that out, what that meant. And we decided that it really meant that, spiritually speaking, we're beggars. We come with nothing in our hands. We have nothing to bring to the Lord. We can't bring our talents, our resources, our good works. We've got nothing to bring. And we begin right on that very first step. That is foundational, to recognize that we have nothing to bring him, but we don't need to bring him anything. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to thy cross I cling. And we can't cling to his cross if our hands are full. So we thought about being a beggar. We're totally empty. The second one follows on from that. For it is, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Now, you might think this is going to be a bit depressing, but don't switch off, because it's not going to be depressing at all. This is going to be life-giving. All of Jesus' teaching is meant to be life-giving. He wants us to have life in all its fullness. Yeah, we've got to look at some difficult issues, but they're not to bring us down. They are to lift us up. He wants to give us wings to allow us to fly. He wants to take the chains off us to allow us to fly. So this is our Jesus. So that's what we're doing today. All his teaching is to set us free. Blessed are those who mourn. Wouldn't it be great if we lived in a world where there was no pain? I think in our world we try our best to do that, don't we? When I was very young, I used to go to a dentist who didn't believe in injections, no matter what he was doing to your teeth. That was not a pleasant experience, but these days you go to the dentist to get a fill-in or a tooth out, you get an injection. You go to hospital to have an operation of some sort, you get an anesthetic. You have aches and pains, we get tablets for that to take away the pain. I'm prone to migraines. I've got these wonderful tablets that I don't want to go anywhere without. When I take one, it goes. We'd love to live in a world without pain, but we know that that is not the reality. We'd like to avoid it, but pain is unavoidable. We're familiar with mourning over someone that we love, someone that we have lost. But why do we mourn? Why does that happen? Both my parents died in the 1980s, a long time ago. But I remember when my mum died and we were very close. It was awful. It was really, really awful. And I remember the day of her funeral, standing beside the graveside and looking into the grave. And the pain was too much to bear. And I remember thinking, if I wasn't a Christian at this point, I think I would become one. Because this is not the way it's meant to be. We're not made for this loss, for this separation. We're made for a relationship. Relationship that don't end. And so to let go of someone is really, really painful. And so we mourn. We experience deep grief because we have been separated from the ones that we love. The relationship is broken. It is too painful. And so we mourn. When we think of our sin and how it separates us from the Lord who loves us and the Lord who we love, as we realize our spiritual poverty, as we thought about last week, we should mourn. As I mourn, I see my sin as God sees it. I don't deny it. I don't hide from it. I grieve over it. And that grief, hopefully, will lead to repentance. And that repentance will change my behavior. Mourning is a very important part of the process. We can't simply pretend that everything's okay. You know, maybe sometimes we feel like that with people who are mourning, who are grieving. We'd love to make it better quickly, but that wouldn't be a healthy thing to do. Mourning, grieving is part of the process. That is a healthy thing to do. You remember the story of David and Bathsheba back in the Old Testament? David was a king, as you know. And when kings were out at war, David had remained in his palace. And you know the story, he was walking in his palace and he sees Bathsheba, who's having a bath. He takes a liking to her. He wants her. He sends his servants to go and get her. It's a bad thing to do. She becomes pregnant. What does David do? David lives in denial. He tries to cover up his sin. Her husband was called Uriah, who was out on the battlefield. He calls to get Uriah to come back and to rest. And he says, Uriah, go and spend some time with your wife. Uriah was an honorable man. He said, I'm not going to take such pleasure whenever my fellow comrades are out in the battlefield. It wouldn't be right. And he wouldn't do it. David's plan was crumbling. So he had to find another way to deal with his sin. So this time, he made sure Uriah went to the fiercest part of the battle, knowing that he would die. David had Uriah killed. An awful thing to do. He refused to acknowledge his sin. What did that feel like? Because it wasn't until maybe almost a year later that David is confronted by the prophet Nathan. Nathan tells him a story. The end of the story is that David realized that he has done something really bad. He's confronted by his sin. And David, being a poet, a songwriter, puts it into words, into music. This is what he writes in Psalm 32. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Acknowledging sin, confessing it, is a healthy thing to do. We know Psalm 51 that Mark read for us. Here are some words from it. After he had been confronted by that, after he had felt the oppression of holding that sin inside, Psalm 51, he writes these words. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions. My sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins. Blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of my salvation. Grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. It's only as we acknowledge our sin, we recognize our poverty. And as we confess it, as we stand before it, as we confront it and take it to the Lord, only when we confess it can that joy return. That's what David found. He lived in denial. He had his schemes and his plans to cover up his dirty old tracks. But his bones were being crushed. His spirit was crushed. He had no joy. And so he prays, Lord, let me know the joy of salvation again. Blot this out. Forgive me. I know what I've done. And the wonderful thing is that our God is a forgiving God. And he wants us to have this joy. He wants us to have life in all its fullness. He wants us to fly on wings like an eagle. He wants to lift us up, not put us down. This is a God who wants to set us free. You, me. So Jesus spoke to his disciples. Said, if you want to know the freedom of knowing me, of following me, this is where it begins. Recognizing that you have nothing. To mourn over your sin. See what happens. Anyone who's a parent, anyone who's got children, knows that children can be challenging. Children can break your heart. But the thing is about being a parent is, when your child hurts, you hurt too. That's what it means to be a parent. Doesn't matter what they've done, what they've said. Doesn't matter how they've broken your heart. They will always be your children. And you love them. And whenever things go wrong, whenever they're hurt, whenever they've gone astray, whatever it might be, what do you want to do with that child? You want to hold them. You want to wipe away the tears from their eyes. You want them to know that you love them. If that's the way we, as human parents, feel, we who are sinful and broken ourselves, if that is the way that we can feel about our children, how much more can our Heavenly Father feel for us? So that when we come confessing and contrite. When we come to him when we have gone wrong, he holds us. He speaks gently to us. And he wipes away every tear from our eyes. If a sinful parent can do it, how much more can God? So that's why Jesus said, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." We're going to respond to what we've heard as we sing a song. And it's the words from Psalm 51, the words of David, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me."
St. Paul says in Philippians 4, verse 6, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God." And so we turn to God with our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your world is going through a time of crisis that it hasn't seen for over 100 years, and the lives of almost everyone have been impacted. For some it's just an annoying inconvenience, for others it's a time of grave concern, stress, anxiety, fear and even grief as they deal with serious illness and death. We start by praying for all those directly impacted by COVID-19, either having fallen ill or having lost a friend, a family member or a work colleague. People feel deprived of the opportunity to say goodbye, and the inability to grieve together is one of the hardest things that people are having to deal with. Please comfort people in their distress, give them a sense of your presence, and bring them closer to you as they reflect on what living is all about. We pray, of course, for everyone in direct healthcare provision, healthcare workers who put themselves in harm's way so that others may have the opportunity to live. They are physically exhausted, they are emotionally drained, and they cry out for the public to do the right thing to help bring an end to the spread of this illness. Help us all to be responsible and to play our part in bringing this virus to its knees, to stay at home, to socially distance ourselves if we have to go out, and to exercise good health hygiene for the sake of ourselves and those we directly and indirectly come in contact with. Oddly for Christians, by keeping away from other people at this time, we show how much we care for them. Help us not to be too hasty in rushing back to our former normality, but help us too to seek out opportunities to help that don't endanger others. We pray for those feeling cut off from the world right now. Help us to keep in touch with those who are elderly, at high risk, or simply living alone, and to bring words of encouragement and a Christian witness that shows we care. We pray for those in stressful family situations right now, thrown together in circumstances less than ideal, and perhaps prone to physical or emotional or financial abuse. Help those bringing relief at the end of a phone, those bringing relief with a box of provisions, and those seeking to keep children entertained, educated and engaged. We pray for those who have lost their jobs or are wondering how they are going to pay their bills. Let them find peace as well as consideration. We pray for those who are currently in direct provision or in temporary accommodation. A hotel room is no place for social distancing, nor for spending 24 hours every day. We pray for our ministers as they seek to form a new government and to protect our nation. And we give thanks that we currently have a medical doctor as our Taoiseach. Everything happens for a reason. We pray for residents of our nursing homes and their carers. They seem to be most at risk and are now separated from their loving families for their own safety. As a nation and as family members, we grow increasingly concerned for them. Finally, O Lord, we pray for those looking for both effective new treatments and the development of a vaccine. Guide them in making the right decisions for an effective and safe solution as they exchange information around the world. We hand all these anxieties over to you, Lord, because, as it says in your word, you care for us. Amen.
So thank you for joining us for our service today. We hope you've been blessed by it, hope you've been renewed by it, and a great way to take into the rest of the day and the rest of the week. We'll meet again tomorrow at noon for our noontime reflection. Tomorrow will be Terry Price will be speaking to us. So that is already recorded and that'll be available from 12 noon on our YouTube channel and also on Facebook. I'll be back at noon on Tuesday. So, shall we join together to pray as we finish? Let us pray. So may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who called you is faithful, and he will do it. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.